I was speaking with someone today, and we were talking about doom. You know, doom is coming on the world, and I said, you know, we could talk about doom till doomsday, right? The two of us, we could. And he said, yeah, you know, we could, because you know what? It may not be looking at his watch. It may be coming up tomorrow, or even a couple hours from now. You know, who knows? It may be coming quite soon, actually. But just talking about doomsday doesn't solve our problem, does it? Our problem is that there isn't a problem. That's our problem. And our problem is that we can't succeed. We cannot accomplish anything. Reality is not goal-oriented. It's not it, you can't we cannot accomplish attain. We can never attain to anything whatsoever. We cannot attain something. Reality is the attainment-free realm. And actually, we're already there. We're already there. Now, in the previous video, we're already in the abiding in the pure land. That video blew my mind so much, I was afraid to do another one in some ways. I said, what's going to happen next? If I keep going like this, I don't know what's going to happen. It's a little scary, actually. So there's a lot of sort of continuity fear, kicked up a lot of continuity fear. Like, wow. I was reading Longchenpa today, and I just read. I said, oh my gosh, that's exactly where we're at. It's exactly where we're at. And then I didn't try to grab it or grasp it mentally. I just put it down and said, wow, just wow. So I always recommend full stop in the wow. Do not forget that. When you come across recognition of how far you've gone, don't try to grasp it. Don't try to struggle with it. Don't try to, you know, just say wow. And just allow that feeling of wow to be there. I know it's tempting to try and reify it and grasp it and turn it into an attainment. But remember, our attainment is the realization there is no attainment. So when we try to turn that realization there is no attainment into an attainment, that's where the struggle happens. And this is where we start to feel that as if there were levels, and we're trying to pull something through and it won't come through, and all this kind of stuff. The way to allow reality to be present in our waking sleep, as I say, there's four states. There's reality, there's deep sleep, 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 and waking sleep. In order to allow reality to be feltly present in waking sleep, which is where most of us have our attention, we need to allow it to be here, not to get it as an attainment, as if waking sleep has realized some sort of state, that there it is, I got it. No, we have to have a different attitude. Very different attitude, and it simply is here, and we're allowing it to be here, not as an attainment, but as that which fundamentally transcends the very notion of attainment, which is pure freedom. So this is what we're working on, is so when we keep stressing this full stop in the wow, we are changing our attitude, and this is what enables reality to emerge into even waking sleep. I mean, in some of it, it's already there in sleeping sleep, and we just have to, this full stop in the wow practice, walking together in the wow, is what enables us to experience the reality, even in this realm of waking sleep, in Zombiria here, where everybody's, you know, zombies, basically, spiritual zombies, and in deep states of zombiness, of forgetfulness. Even here in Zombiria, we're able to allow the presence of reality. We're able to allow this. So, full stop in the wow. Whenever you realize, oh my gosh, I understand reality, I'm in tune with it, just say, oh, wow. Don't turn it into a success, an attainment, a realization, or anything like that. It's not a state. It's not a state of mind. It's freedom itself. It's freedom itself, which has its own feeling. Longchenpa calls it sky-like spaciousness, as it were. But let us keep in mind that this is only a metaphor. It is not really talking about the sky. It's a subtle metaphor for tremendous sameness, for this vast, immutable sameness. And this is what we got to in the video, we're already abiding in the pure land. Is this the sameness? I think a video before that too, we spoke about, and I became aware of the sameness. It's just this absolute sameness. Everything is in the absolute same condition. This is what is meant by the metaphor of the sky, and many of these adepts have used this, referencing the sky and the emptiness and all that. But it really is sameness, is what they're getting to, is the sameness. And so the feeling of sameness, this vast sameness that nothing is separate from, is what we can allow to emerge in this waking sleep that we're in, which is the lowest, it's the deepest form of forgetfulness. The deepest forgetfulness is this waking sleep that we're in. Using words, believing in causation, linear causation, and all this stuff. Whereas when we're sleeping, we tend to be much more creative, and truth emerges for us, for me, very strongly, very strongly. And I say, hey, wow, I understand perfectly well. You know, and yet then we go into this waking sleep during our daytime activities, and it you know, poof, gone. Carriage turns into a pumpkin. So we are in high-speed pursuit of allowing truth, reality, this vast sameness to emerge, as it were, like a bubble. And so it's like we're somehow like surrounded by this bubble. The world might see it that way. Bubble people have arrived. The bubble people have arrived. Arrival of the bubble people. Yeah, I once had a dream like that that showed that you can call them the orb people, the bubble people, but orb implies some sort of energetic orb about you. Now, there may be some corollary, but really it's not that. It's just simply the emergence of truth into this waking sleep. So the arrival of the bubble people. It's bubblicious. That is for sure. So we are working on it, we are working on it, we are working on it, and it is time very well spent. Thank goodness we're working on it. Thank God we're working on it. Thank the grace of God we're working on it. Thank the grace of God is that it manifests in many different ways. Sometimes you see a license plate that just, wow. I saw a license plate today that was quite incredible. It was like perfectly coded for me. Just after I'd asked for a miracle, I said, please, I need a miracle today. And the license plate just was amazing. It reminded me of a experience in sleeping sleep I had where I realized the truth. And this license plate reminded me and pointed out that, hey, don't forget that. You know, you've got to keep on keeping on here. In non-goal fixation, non-attainment fixation, non-realization fixation. And we are certainly very close. So what do you do? Full stop in the wow. So it's been like a week of full stop in the wow for me. And it's springtime today. First day of spring, right? So I believe it is great opportunity now for the bubble people to start, you know, popping up from the depths of the ocean. suddenly surfacing. The bubble people have finally surfaced. It's like we've taken this bubble from the bottom of the ocean or something. There's different ways to look at it. And then we floated up, and finally, pop, we emerge, you know, in the surface of the ocean. And yeah, we're in this bubble. And people say, wow, what is this? Some will say it's bubblicious, and some won't say that. But who's who? We don't know exactly. We don't know exactly what's going to, how everything will go. But it's good to throw a monkey wrench into our waking sleep. Very good to throw a monkey wrench, because the history is littered with the torn pages of. No monkey wrenches being thrown into the situation. And what happens with that is not good at all, actually. We tend to overlook that. The secular empires in history have been in constant warfare and aggression and expansion and all this kind of stuff. And then religion comes in and tries to, you know, tone it down, tries to calm it down. It's not easy to tone it down. If you look at history, it's ridiculous. It's really ridiculous, the constant warfare. And, you know, vanity of vanities. And so you're dealing with people who are you know, have this incredibly this perspective, mindset and perspective born of self-delusion, and it is not easy to tone it down. So certainly throwing these monkey wrenches into the history of the world has actually been a good thing, even though it hasn't, you know, cured, hasn't resulted in ultimate cure, as it were, but it has certainly toned it down from what it used to be, the tribalism of the past. So time to toss some more monkey wrenches into the waking sleep of the world. Throw some bubble people in there, and the zombies try to bite them, you know, and they break their teeth on the bubble, and they react like zombies. You know how zombies react, like, I'm coming to get you, and like, boom, they hit the bubble, and like, whoa, what in the world is that? And then they start, you know, start thinking, you know, it's, And then they go to their, you know, dog mind, animal mind, and say, try to figure it out that way. And that doesn't work very well. They say, I wonder if there's any other mind I can use that's not so stupid, can figure this out. You know, I mean, dogs can figure stuff out. There were some dogs where I was today, and lovely dogs, wonderful dogs. And I was threw a ball for them a bunch of times. I like animals, I do, but you know, and the dog's so attentive, and but it's focused at a certain level. You know, it's focused at, you know, that's its focus, that's its thing. But dog mind is never going to be able to recognize what our situation is really about. And so you have to use divine mind actually to clarify you know, dog mind, cat mind, animal mind, that's not going to work. It's not going to work. And so the world needs to be challenged, and so they can start calling upon divine mind, which is always available to everyone, the voice of reason within us, the Holy Spirit. Divine mind has to inform us of this is the real situation, the situation, pretend situation. All this is a masquerade, a pretense, actually. All situations are pretenses. All conditions are pretenses. We are simply having a grand masquerade, and we're so good at it that we're sort of enamored of how good we are at it. And we kind of think that it's so great that it somehow transcended reality. It's no longer a masquerade. It's reality now. But it's not. You know, we are very good at it. But just because we're good at something doesn't mean that we're able to change reality by that. Our creativity is unlimited, except that it can't change reality. It cannot change our perfect freedom, our perfect safety. It cannot change the nature of reality. And we're trying to see if we can be greater than God, and we figured out the way to do it was to discover a problem with reality. We say, God, you think you're a perfect creator, that's what you told us, and you told us that we're perfect and you're perfect, but we discover there's a flaw in reality. And because we were able to discover this flaw and that you were not aware of, that means that makes us greater than you. See? So we're pretending that there's this flaw with reality by going through this masquerade of all this horrible stuff. If you really study history, which I certainly do, you know, at some point you just have to stop and just say, wow, you know, this world has just been an absolute lunatic asylum. Really. The more you know about truth and reality, looking back on history, you realize it. We have just been, you can't call it evolution. It's way too crazy for evolution. It's ridiculous to call it evolution. No, we have just been berserk. We've been crazy. We've been insane. We're having a berserk masquerade. We're masquerading as berserkers, as lunatics. And just making up massive amounts of belief, all of it rubbish, absolute rubbish. You know, the belief systems, they're looking at the past, you know, it's just, you know, when you read the truth, for instance, Longchenpa, the radical Dzogchen of the Vajra heart, something like that, spaciousness, the radical Dzogchen of the Vajra heart, someone who really knows the truth, and then compare it with the rubbish of historical beliefs, which are, I mean, every tribe had their pantheon of gods and goddesses and taboos and all this stuff. It's just unbelievable, the rubbish dump of history. Now, speaking of that, last night I woke up at 4 in the morning and I started practicing the great Vajrayana practice that I'm using now. You can call it that. It's a diamond drill practice of I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And just say that matter-of-factly over and over. I started doing that. And because I had some awful dream that I was stuck in so terribly, and I just said I couldn't resolve it. So I just started practicing, and I found myself as if I were traveling through solid solidity, but what it was massive, like a rubbish dump that had compressed over thousands and thousands and thousands of years. And I was going through all the layers of this rubbish dump, and it was so bizarre. It was, and somehow I was just able to pass through it with this, by using this practice. I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I was going through all these layers that had been laid down throughout history, all this ridiculous rubbish belief and toxicity, and I was just like, are you kidding me? I mean, there's no ride at Disneyland that can even remotely approach such a journey like this. I said, wow, all this sludge, all the sediment, all this gunk, all this goo, all this nasty craziness. And I wasn't being touched by it. I was just passing through, and I was aware of the form and the feel, how to look like, but it wasn't touching me at all. It was not touching me at all, because I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. So this seemed to be, no doubt, I was going through all of the rubbish dump of history. And really, history is nothing but a big rubbish dump, a big landfill of discarded nonsense. It's all nonsense. History is total nonsense, actually. We still don't get it. We still don't get it, but there are some that have, and they fortunately have left some clarifications for us, so we can at least avail ourselves of those. But by and large, today we're producing more rubbish than ever, actually. And it's piling up so fast. We're being buried by it. It's like our mind is just seemingly buried under this massive mountain of rubbish. And so, but this practice, I found myself simply floating through it, traveling through it without, it wasn't stopping me. I didn't feel like I was hitting any solid, like I had blocks or anything. It was like I was like formless, and I was just slowly traveling through all these forms of insanity. Really. But it didn't affect me at all. I just kept practicing. But I was like, sometimes I would stop and I'd just say, are you kidding me? That is really weird. I say, oh, no, come on. It's hard not to stop and take a look at this stuff. But I kept trying to just say, I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So this is, this practice is profound, but you can see how it's quite a trip it takes you on. And you have to really be able to just kind of go with it and have faith in it and really just say, yeah. And have a sense of entitlement. If there's one thing I can say about the world and trying to succeed in the worldly world, the waking sleep of Zomberia, is how do people succeed? I always wondered. It's who you know more than what you know, but it's even more than that. It's entitlement. People succeed because of entitlement. The reason why people go to these prestigious schools and all this kind of stuff is there's an overall cultural entitlement built up around all of this. And what they teach you there is entitlement. Because the content, it's not that difficult. And the people who graduate aren't that smart, actually. Not really. They don't know very much at all. In fact, they have spiritual dementia, all of them. Graduating from a university doesn't mean anything spiritually at all. Did Jesus graduate from a university? Did Buddha graduate from a university? No. Did Longchenpo graduate from a university? No. Et cetera. Nandamayama or Mahamaharshi? No. Not at all. But what they have been taught is entitlement. And entitlement is a very tough cookie to deal with. And I run into this all the time in my work. Is the people I work for are super entitlement people, and it's just something that they don't even think about. It's just their body language, the way they move and everything. It's like, I'm entitled and you're not. I mean, I have greater entitlement than you, and there's nothing to talk about. It's just, this is just how it is. This is just how it is. So they believe it's some sort of manifest destiny. This is just the way it is. Okay. So the problem we have is is the lack of entitlement, lack of spiritual entitlement here in this world, that we've gotten away from that so much. To really succeed in allowing truth to emerge here in waking sleep, we need a sense of entitlement. We need a sense of entitlement because the world runs on entitlement. And if people can see that you're entitled to this, they feel you're entitled to it, then they're okay with it. If they feel you're not entitled to it, then they're absolutely not okay with it. It doesn't matter what you know, or even who you know, or what you say, or what you do. It's entitlement, which is hard to pin down exactly, but it's many little things. If you have it, you have it. If you don't have it, you don't have it. Because there's all these subtle deferments that automatically pop up. You could, if you went to Harvard, you could even get elected president of the United States, anyone could. The entitlement is so strong there, actually. If you want to use it that way, you can find that people will defer to you. And if you really want to, push it, if that's your ambition, then you can actually get people will vote for you because, they're deferring to your entitlement. You say, I'm entitled to be president. And they'll say, oh, okay. So, but what's beyond president? What's beyond Pontus Maximus? What's beyond, you know, what is beyond, how do we get entitlement for that? So this is a question. And so far, I've not been able to fully answer that question. I believe I've failed because I don't. It's hard to push to get this entitlement feeling in this world. It really is. Maybe that's why people go see gurus, go see teachers, etc. Is then that this what's conveyed upon them is this, you know, entitlement. Sure, you're part of this lineage and you're entitled to enlightenment. And then maybe you say, okay, and then that's it. All things, everything else being equal, I mean that it's you already, you know, have worked it through and recognized, etc. But there's this still this entitlement situation, and you can say, yeah, I met Buddha, I met this and this and that. But if it doesn't produce, you know, this overall sort of sense of I'm entitled to be enlightened, then there's a problem. So this world seems to be dedicated to telling you you're not entitled to be enlightened. During this day and age, and this is a large part of the problem. So what I'm trying to do here in these videos is give people a sense of entitlement, but it's not strong enough. It's not strong enough. Now some people say they're going to heaven because they believe in Jesus, whatever that means, and they're entitled to it. You know, I look at these people who are saying, you know, they're getting ready for the rapture and they think that they're ready for reality. Yeah, I say, what are you talking about? I mean, and then their beliefs and attitudes are completely pagan, dualistic. They have no sense of the vast matrix of sameness. And they're not ready for reality at all. The farthest thing from it almost. But they have a sense of entitlement. They think, well, we're entitled to it. Because we're, you know, they say, you know, believing in Jesus, believing that Jesus, something, someone died for their sins, or however it goes. So that brings about the feeling of them like, yeah, I'm going to get what I want because I'm entitled to it. And of course, if you don't believe as they believe, then they say, well, you're not entitled to it. Right? You're not entitled to it. And this is the clash in this world is about entitlements. So we can ask the Holy Spirit how to break the deadlock on this, how to get the lid off. You know, sometimes people give me jars with the lids are super hard to get off, and they know I'm going to get the lid off. You know, sometimes they're really difficult actually, but I don't stop until I get it. Well, one of the ones I did recently was very tough. It was a real, but I did it. It took a long time. It was really something. So we need to get the lid off of this entitlement issue. And when people start realizing, hey, I am entitled to what? To truth. To reality. To waking up from sleep. Waking up from a dream. I'm entitled to awaken from a dream. You know, and people say, well, not until our chief tells you you can. You know, that kind of thing. See, you understand the past is tribal. It's very tribal. And these, a lot of these chiefs that they talk about, religious chiefs, you know, they look at them in a tribal sense. And they say, well, we can't do anything till the chief tells us. And nobody else can do anything. If anyone else from some other tribe does something that our chief hasn't told them they can do that, then we're going to make war upon that tribe, you know, because they're disrespecting our chief or chiefess, as the oftentimes behind the chief are the Vestal Virgins, you know, the chiefesses. And even the chief has to bow in their presence, you know. So this tribalness that, you know, is that the world thinks you can't have a sense of entitlement until our chief tells you. Our chiefess tells you you can. And so how do you flip the script without seeing me completely arrogant? So I don't know. Because really, you can say, well, you know, actually, My chief, Trump's your chief, and my chief hasn't given you a sense of entitlement to tell me that I can't have a sense of entitlement. You know, it gets in, it can easily get into this conflict like that. So we're just asking the Holy Spirit to give us the very wise answer to this. It's time, it's time, it's time for the bubble people to emerge in their little microclimate bubble, their little paradise microclimate. Of truth, of reality, of isness, of this absolute sameness. All is equally abiding in pure spaciousness in the moment. Everything is like completely the same at that, in that way. Absolutely the same. There's no difference at all. Never will be. And so this realization can emerge here. Absolutely, it can emerge here. Right now, it's not emerging because of this entitlement issue, which I've been working on my entire life and still have not cracked that nut, haven't got the lid off of it yet. But the lid could pop off at any moment. I mean, once you work, you know, it somehow, like the lid is the last one I did, it was, I said, wow, maybe I'm never going to get this. But I just kept putting maximum effort into it, and finally, pop, you know, just pop like that. I said, wow, thank goodness that popped. But so we might feel like we're never going to get the lid off of it, but we have to keep trying maximum effort. And son of a gun, if suddenly, at one moment, suddenly, pop, you know, the lid just, that's it. And then the contents, you know, are available to us. And this is what we're looking for. Now, I thought, because of a previous life where I had so much entitlement, that I thought it'd be easy. I say, it's not a problem. I got so much entitlement. I'm used to getting my way. And I was one of those people who was in the very high upper echelons of entitlement. And so everybody deferred to me. Really, you just walk down the street, everybody defers, you know, and and so it's easy to approach people and talk with them and everything because they'll allow you to do that. You know, because, oh yeah, sure, oh, someone says talk, oh, great, great, great. And so I said, no, it's easy to come into this world, and all I do is come into the world, and I'll just go around strolling and just walk up to people, like they're friends, strangers, and treat them like a friend and say, hey, let me, you know, what do you know about salvation? Let's talk about it and stuff. And I thought it would be easy to do that, to transfer the entitlement I had from one lifetime to another. But the entitlement I had back then did not have to do with salvation. It had to do with music. So when I tried to speak to people about salvation here, I found out that they reacted as if I had no entitlement to do so. And I said, what are you talking about? You know, I have the entitlement. And they said, no, you don't. What are you talking about? And so there's conflict arose, you know, conflict. So I found that I could not transfer the entitlement of cultural and social success and wealth and influential friends, powerful friends, kings and queens and industrialists and all, you know, powerful, powerful entitlement people, you know, really. I couldn't transfer that to salvation, talking about salvation here. It failed to transfer, much to my extreme shock. And obviously I must have not listened to my advisors. They must have advised me, hey, it doesn't transfer that way. And I said, no, you'll see. You know, so I was overconfident. Which is understandable. If you have a life where you have extreme entitlement and everybody defers to you, and you can even, you know, disagree with you know, the highest people, and that's okay because, you know, you have the entitlement to say what you want to say, really. I could say anything I wanted to say and nobody could tell me that I couldn't say it. We could disagree, but you know, people in entitlement can disagree, and they say, that's okay. You know, we're entitled to say what we want to say, and so are you, and it's not a problem, really. But I found that didn't work. When you talk about salvation, it's a different story, because you're getting into the fear factor, the continuity fear factor with people, and that overrides all their social conditioning to try and treat people with kindness and deference and civility. And even if you have extreme people are feel they need to defer to you because of entitlement, even if you have extreme entitlement, this fear that they have of salvation, of enlightenment, of liberation, is so strong, it overrides that. It overrides it. And they become, you know, hostile. And I said, hey, wait a minute, whoa, you know, do you know who you're talking with? What are you getting hostile for? And they got even more hostile. Because that goes out the window. It goes out the window. But without, you know, so what is it that enables people to defer to enlightenment is the question. What is it? It certainly isn't success from any other sphere, is it? It most certainly isn't. So I tend to say, well, I tend to have the attitude that they won't defer to anything here. But that could be wrong. That might be mistaken. So this question needs to be answered. This is one of the stumbling blocks that still remains. It's a big one. It may be as simple as you actually being able to recognize who they really are. You being able to see through their masquerade, you see. And when they recognize that you're able to see through their masquerade, then they're going to defer to what you have to say. And deferment is a subtle thing, but it's an entitlement situation where they actually pay attention and listen and can benefit from it. It might be something as simple as that. So I spoke earlier in another video about the need to see everybody as divine, have a divine origin, even though it may seem to be fractional. It appears fractional, it would be, at least initially, maybe it appears fractional to us. But it's there, and since it's there, we can recognize that we're of divine origin, actually. To use a crude term, origin, you know, it's like some sort of ancestry. It's really not that way, but we are divine, actually. Maybe that's the that initiation I had in a dream of some rishi, Indian rishi-like character, putting that red dot on my, you know, my forehead, that bindu, or that mark there. Maybe that's like the mark of divinity or something. The ability to recognize that, or maybe that's what that he was getting at. But maybe if we recognize the divinity in others, that might be enough to have this entitlement situation where then you can freely converse with people, and you know that appropriate deferment is there, and there's not an entitlement battle going on, because society cannot function if there's a constant entitlement battles going on. And this is tribalism, you know, each tribe says, we're entitled to this land. And no, we are, and we're entitled. Our God is entitled to obedience from you, that you need to be the slaves of our God. Our God's greater and needs slaves, so you need to be slaves. And the other tribe says, no, you are. Our God's greater, and you need to be slaves. So if there are all these entitlement battles going on, it's chaos here. It's chaos. But if you can unequivocally see the divinity in others, no matter what they say, you know, you're not fooled at all. You're not fooled. And then pretty soon, you know, this carries with it some sort of aura that people can feel. And they recognize, oh, okay, no use trying to fool this one. You know, I can let my guard down a little bit here because they already know, and it's okay. They can say, oh, they already know, and it's okay. So looking for something to drink. Is there anything to drink? They say, okay, I'm going to let my guard down a little bit. So, question, how to see that all is divine? Now, I've been recognizing this subtly recently. It's sort of creeping up on me. It's like creeping up. I sort of have these experiences where I sort of feel like it's there. It's there. I'm just not paying enough attention to it. It's like that. It seems quite subtle. And you can't really put your finger on it. But it is there indeed. And maybe if we recognize that that's actually our entitlement, that maybe then we'd see it. So maybe we're looking for entitlement in all the wrong places. Let's talk about looking for love in all the wrong places. How about looking for entitlement in all the wrong places? Maybe that's what's holding us back, wasting our time. Maybe when we recognize, hey, seeing the divinity in everyone is the entitlement we've been looking for, because that's pragmatically necessary to help others. It's necessary. It puts everyone on a footing of saying, hey, I can just, it's okay for me to shut up and listen. Which, of course, if you shut up and listen, that's when you gain, have the most success and learn the most. And people today, there's not enough of people of spiritual entitlement for people to shut up and listen. And so everybody's just talking too much. With lack of wisdom. You know, I talk a lot here, but it's understood the context here is we're looking for what we truly need. And so we're trying to look in the right direction here and practicing full stop in the wow. But what I mean about talking too much is blah, 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 blah. I know this. I know the answer to this, that I'm, you know, it's just all this trying to generate some sort of entitlement complex. But what they really need is to be quiet and listen to those who know the truth. And yet, the only way that's going to happen is if the entitlement balance shifts and they realize, hey, I don't really have the entitlement to try to shut this person up. But I feel like I need to listen here. I need to listen and pay attention, close attention. And then they start getting, you know, the answers they've been looking for. So, this is the pragmatic key to the situation. And so we're getting closer to it. We're getting a lot closer to it. That's my phone going. Let me see if I can, what I can do about that. It's going to cause me troubles. Maybe I'll just shut it off. It's going to make a weird sound here. But I'll just shut the phone down. Okay. Gone. down the drain. So we are certainly getting much closer here. As we say, maybe the reason why we don't see divinity in everyone is because we don't see that as giving us any sense of entitlement. We haven't put two and two together yet. And so it's there. It's there. It's just like in the sort of in the periphery, right? It's just. I'm noticing that. I say, hey, wait a minute. Is that it? It's kind of like, is that it? And I can't even tell you what it is yet because I don't pay that much attention to it. But I've been having those experiences recently. Say, hey, wait a minute. That it seems like I've seen them as divine. I saw someone talking on their phone. I saw somebody. What was it? Someone in the car next to me was talking on a phone or something. And I say, hey, wait a minute, they're divine. I say, that just shows they're divine to me. But I can't explain it to you. But I felt that, oh, maybe that's it. Maybe it's it. So this is today it happened. I said, maybe this is it. But I didn't put enough attention on it. So again, maybe our problem is we don't realize that is the entitlement that we're seeking for. And if we realize that, then we're going to put our attention on it, and then it'll become obvious to us. So it's actually already obvious. It's just that we're not putting any value on it because we think, well, there's no entitlement there, so that doesn't solve my problem at all. So we keep looking to impress people with how smart we are. We need entitlement. We need entitlement. Entitlement, you know. Listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. You know, I got entitlement. So here we're very humble, severely modest, very humble, recognizing we don't have the entitlement yet. We don't have it. I certainly don't have it. And this is being honest with yourself and realizing what doesn't work. You know, I've been through so many, many ways that don't work. You know, I just thought if I do this really good, I'll get entitlement. If I do this, I'll get entitlement. So I've tried so many ways that don't work. It's a lifetime of extreme effort in trying to find entitlement enough to so people will then be able to listen to truth. But I tried entitlements that don't work. Don't work. They don't work. But that's a valuable resource for someone who has a great understanding of what doesn't work. That can be quite helpful. But if you don't have the ultimate entitlement, nobody's going to listen to you. Or a few will listen to you. Few. The ones listening are the ones who have already tried a lot of stuff too, and they realize, hey, that doesn't work either. And so we're walking together in the wow here to discover, you know, what is true entitlement? What is true entitlement? And that's what's really helpful. That's what gets the Ivy League, you know, standouts. They even sit down and shut up. That's true. Everybody does. Everybody says, wow, okay. Which is good, which is throwing a monkey wrench into everything because what we got now is not working very well. It's everyone strained. There's a lot of entitlement battles taking place in the world right now, as a matter of fact, that we, you know, it's still the old Parthian, you know, empire, and the Roman Empire still at it. You know, I thought you know 700 plus years was enough, but apparently not. And so we have all sorts of entitlement battles taking place in the world, do we not? Very much so. Very much so. You can name the players. There's many players. Everyone feels, so many people, countries in the world feel tremendous sense of entitlement that they should be the ones that everybody else listens to and basically enslaving everybody else. Corporations have a tremendous sense of entitlement. Races do. Genders do. Countries, you know, religions, technology, science, on and on and on. There's these massive entitlement battles going on. And the best thing to do for all of us is throw a monkey wrench into it all, you know, where people from all these different entitlement complexes can come together and say, hey, wait a minute, you know, what have we been doing? This is ridiculous. You know, we need to just shut up and listen and find out the truth of our being. And now we have the excuse to do it. Whereas before, you know, we're just talking to somebody else. So we feel we have equal entitlement to them. So there, you know, there's a contest going on. And build up the military, you know. And it's being run by vanity and vanity of vanities and desire for, you know, mirror, mirror on the wall. You know, who's the fairest of them all kind of thing. That's an entitlement right there. I mean, there's entitlement battles about beauty is something. Vanity is really driving the whole thing. Always has. That's an extremely important part of it. Is, you know, hey, who's beautiful enough to claim entitlement that they can get all the accoutrement of beauty, you know? Who gets all the diamonds? Who gets the best hairdresser? You know, who gets the best stylist, you know, fashion designer? Who gets the best, you know, perks? And who's the highest, fairest of them all, so to speak? And that rages constantly, raging. Who gets into the best schools? You know, it's all this massive egoic rat race of entitlement taking place with no resolution in sight, because, you know, it's just crabs clawing one another. You know, one, you know, you see people in the seafood market, this little glass aquarium of crabs, and they're trying to climb out, and the other crabs grab them, and they pull them back down, and they just, all the claws are all snapping, and just like, it's like that. There's a bunch of crabs. The whole world is just all crabby. And I tried to bring the, you know, I tried, even tried to bring the gurus of the past into the present, saying, hey, look, you know, I'm affiliated with this teacher, which is true. These teachers are my friends. But that wasn't enough. And they said, well, I mean, that was entitlement back then. This is now. You know, it doesn't count. Doesn't count. So, many things I've tried, many ways I've tried to get people to shut up and listen to the truth. Just be quiet. You know, sit down and shut up. Essentially is what people need to do. The whole world needs to sit down and shut up. Which is exactly what I would tell them if I had the entitlement to do so. Sit down, shut up, listen. Put all your preconceived notions, all that's just rubbish. You know, you're crowing about a garbage dump, a landfill. You're saying, look at my area of the landfill. Look at what, it's just all garbage. And so don't, stop crowing about garbage. People's belief systems, they're garbage. They're absolute garbage. And deep down they know it. But they would keep wanting to say, you know, well, my garbage is better than your garbage. Essentially, that's what the whole world is at, you know. Zambiria is all about my garbage is better than your garbage. My sludge is better than your sludge. My cesspool is better than your cesspool, you know. It's like that, really. It's like just like that. My sewage smells better than your sewage. Is in the world in a nutshell can be described just like that. My sewage smells better than your sewage. And therefore you need to worship my sewage, you know, that kind of thing. You need to say my sewage is better. It smells better. It smells better. The other says, no, it doesn't. Mine's better. Yeah, they're pulling each other's hair and screaming at each other. Holy cow. You got all the maids driving Mercedes now, and they say, my maid's got a better car than your maid. Really, seriously. I have better servants than your servants. Look at my servants, they're driving Mercedes. So it's just that. That's all it is. And when you are in self-delusion, what else can you do except to say my sewage smells better than your sewage? That's all you can do. That's all you can do. Until you come across some entitlement that you just go, whoa, I feel like just shutting up, sitting down, shutting up and listening. And I enjoy it. I say, I like this. I feel like this is what I should do. And then the dawn begins for them. And then they say, wow, I'm glad that it has started, you know, this is great. I'm tired of this rubbish stuff. I'm tired of all the sewage, you know. I'm tired of this ridiculous saying my sewage smells better than yours. It all smells terrible. And it's a relief to realize, wow, I don't have to get in these sewage wars anymore. You know, it's just, you know, it's like my corpse is better than your corpse. Remember back in the 70s, was it Charlie or something? Charlie. You know, I'm wearing Charlie or something. My corpse smells better than your corpse. That's literally what they're doing. Is literally this world is my corpse smells better than your corpse. And this charnel house is what it really is. I'm going to have a better tombstone than you. You know, who are you to talk? I'm going to have a better tombstone than you. My rotting is going to be better than your rotting. Yeah. When I rot, my decay is going to be not nicer than your decay. And of course, nobody wants to be doing this, really. Nobody wants to be doing it, but this world got its head turned by the pretty lady of technology, high technology, which was all part of a plan. I said it's the takeover of this planet, the incorporation of this planet into cosmic corporate culture. And the marketing device they use, this very pretty lady of high tech, and the way they have marketed it and everything, that we all think, wow, you know, we think that they're entitled to our wow, you know, to the wowness, that they're entitled to the wowness. Now, what we do here is we take our wowness and we put it onto what is really entitled to our wowness, which is truth. So our full stop on the wow is for truth. Truth is the wow. Like, wow, that's tremendous. Whereas the world has misplaced their wowness and put it onto this pretty marketing lady of technology, high technology. It's really, you know, sleek, very sleek Austin Martin type of, you know, racy lady of high tech technology. Everyone says, wow. People say, wow. You know, this is misplacement of the wow. So this is what happens to the secular materialists, the humanists, the pagans, all this stuff, the human potentialists, all this stuff. They misplace their wow. They put their wow onto sewage, essentially. And they say, wow, this sewage seems to smell better than the other sewage we're used to. And this corpse seems to be better than the other corpses. And they for a while lose track of the fact they're still talking about corpses. They're still talking about sewage. They for a while they take their eye off the prize, and they fall into this, you know, terrible situation. The situation deepens for them of trouble, of troubledness, and battling over entitlements. We were talking about yesterday the how difficult it is to be a fireman around this area, and it's just almost impossible, because nobody's more entitled than firemen here, right? You retire when you're 50, 80, what, 80%, 90% pension for life, and the way they work it is they get their last salary so high that the pension is very high. Yeah. So really the 80 or 99, 80%, 85% of a super high salary in their last year is more than their normal salary for most of their years. So they're getting, like, you know, full pension or more for the rest of their lives after the age of 50, which, you know, could be 40 years or more of that, right? So to be a fireman now is just incredibly difficult situation. And of course, because the funds are not sufficient for to pay these pensions, instead of hiring new firefighters, they just don't hire anymore. So the ones that do have the pensions, all the money goes to their retirement instead of paying to hire, you know, new firefighters. So it's really an interesting situation. Very tough to get that entitlement. But hundreds of people are desperately trying, doing anything, working for free, for years and years working for free to try to get that very important entitlement from the way they see it. So the whole world is in this stronger and stronger rat race. You can tell by the way that people drive. People are saying, wow, I'm in an entitlement race here. You know, I can't let you in. This bus just completely... I was going on a main street, and there's a side street, the school bus. It was on a side street. I had the right of way entirely. What did they do? They just pulled right out and forced me off of the side of the road. I had to stop on the side of the road. There was a lady driving this bus, and she just said, hey, you know, like, you know, hey, you know, it's, I don't know what it meant. But I guess she said, hey, I'm entitled to push you off the side of the road. And I just went myself, just, really? Really? Okay. And then later on, gridlock. We got gridlock now. And the intersection was green light for me, and the cross street, the main street I was turning onto, was everyone was in the intersection, and there was this lady there was in the intersection, and she let me in. I said, Thank you. Thank you very much. You see, so some people are still trying, so an older person, and they're still trying to keep up the appearances of I'm not so craven that I'm going to fight tooth and claw to gain some, you know, say that my sewage smells better than your sewage. There's still some older people that maintain their dignity, you know. Not easy, but I appreciate it. Occasionally somebody, I try to let people in whenever I can, you know. Whenever I can, yeah, sure, go ahead. I'm not so desperate to, you know, I'm not so desperate to grab some crumb of entitlement. Nowadays in the Silicon Valley, like we're down to the level below dogs. I mean, I don't even know what level we've ascended to here. Sorry, I shouldn't even say dogs because dogs are wonderful creatures. But we're at some low level. I don't even know how to put it, but where we take one car space now is worth people fighting over, you know, in traffic. And if somebody can just advance one car space, they feel like they've reached some entitlement victory. This is where we're at right now. That entitlement victories are so important. They're battling over the smallest little thing here. That I can get ahead of you. I say, there's a parking space yesterday, and there's a lady there in a car, and I had the right of way, and the parking lot was jammed, and so I had the right to pull into this parking space, and she came, you know, on the side area of the parking lot, and she saw it too, you know, and then she looked at me and said, she realized I saw it first, and he's like, but can I go? Can I go? And I could tell. She's like, I really wanted that space. I really want that space. I really want. And I said, you know what? If you really want that space so much, I'm not going to fight you over it. You know, I'm not going to, you know, I'm not going to make myself look like aggressive that I'm, you know. So I said, go ahead, take the space. Go ahead, take it. I said, oh, thank you. And then I ended up driving around the parking lot. Of course, there's no spaces I couldn't find. But then I went to this other place, and there was two spaces. So it worked out okay for me. But I said, I'm not going to get all worked up and aggressive battling over a parking space, trying to say who has an entitlement. That is just stupid. But because of that, if you're that way, you tend to be sinking down in society because you're not willing to battle over all this ridiculous stuff here. There, people here in the Silicon Valley, which is the heart of entitlement in the world, really, that, you know, these young people here, they're getting the jobs at Facebook and Google and Yahoo and YouTube and Intel and eBay and on and on and on and on and on. You know, they're the top people in entitlement. I mean, they feel we're entitled to these jobs. So they feel they're entitled to everything they want. And so their attitudes here is just intense here. Just walking, just going anywhere in markets, anywhere, you just feel this intense sense of entitlement. I was at this place today that was just uber rich, uber old money, and, you know, super entitlement, and they're a little less aggressive about it. Actually, they just they've been living with super money for generations, actually, so they're not nearly as aggressive, but you can feel this like the radiating entitlement is really something. These are the patricians, you know, and they're even more powerful wives and children, etc. This is the horsey class, the class of people that just have, you know, massive amounts of land and money, etc. But it's a little low key there. They don't feel like they have to prove anything. But these nouveau riche people, these younger people, wow, we're entitled. And if you don't have a tremendous sense of entitlement yourself, you get bulldozed here, absolutely bulldozed. And so just driving here is just like, it's no fun anymore. I'm telling you, it's no fun anymore because you just get pushed around. And then you have to throw your weight around but I don't like doing that. I don't like doing that. But it's hard to hold your head up. I walk with my head down now because it's hard to... Who wants to keep battling over all this status stuff, you know? Who cares about what kind of shoes you're wearing or something? It's just ridiculous. So, this is the world. This is the world we live in. Where we're tremendous battlements over entitlement are taking place on the most petty level, and it's getting more and more petty all the time. And people are becoming are more and more status conscious. They look at you and they just, you know, size you up, everything materially about you. You know, they pigeonhole you immediately. They're becoming people. Well, how do you see the divine in people if you're that way? You see, is that leading everyone to see the divine in everyone? No. What I saw today was something about the struggle, that everybody's struggling, and somehow that to me that showed that they're divine, because they have the ability to be aware of the divinity, because they're desperate for something. It's the desperation I saw, or something, the struggle, the desperation, this attitude of saying, something isn't right, I need attainment. You know, this actually shows you that the divinity within. Right, because they're saying no matter what I do, it's not good enough. I can't attain. I'm not able to attain. There's something missing. So that actually, you know, I said, ah, so that's the clue. That clues us in. Interesting. Something along those lines. There's something there within us that tips us, that tips us off, gives the game away. We're dissatisfied. The mask doesn't satisfy us enough. We're all saying, I'm not really this person, but I need to make this person better because I'm not getting the recognition that I deserve. Of course, because we're divine. How can we get the recognition we deserve by trying to make people react to think that what we are these bodies? How can that ever get the recognition we truly deserve, which is we're absolutely perfect, flawless, total sovereignty over all possible experiencing, we're eternal life, you know, on and on and on and on. How can we get that type of recognition through somebody? You know, there's this guy in a Ferrari today, this uber fancy Ferrari, and dressed up in all the right kind of chic. Of, you know, I'm Joe CEO, and you know, it's like, wow, you know, and you have to look at the car and everything, because it's like, wow. And that's what they're hoping, you know, that they say they're getting recognition, they're getting entitlement, you know. But how is that entitlement? Hey, you drive a Ferrari and you're probably leasing a Ferrari for how much, maybe $3,000 a month or something. And how does that give you the recognition you really deserve as, you know, Spirit, Son of God? How does that give you the recognition? Does it? Is that sufficient recognition? And this is the trouble with the megalomaniacs who seize control of situations and demagogues, etc. They're desperate for recognition, and they use their political the clout that they have to start forcing people to worship them and say how great they are. You see, it becomes compulsory. Like, for instance, like Mike Stalin, for instance, or, you know, Mao, and on you can, those are some obvious examples, but throughout history, Catherine the Great of Russia, for instance, and these people, you know, off with your head if you don't acknowledge, given them the entitlement, acknowledgement. But it's never enough, because you're acknowledging their person, you know. That's never enough. Not even faintest shadow of enough. So once they get in that megalomaniacal mode, heads start rolling. And we certainly don't want that. And so to prevent that, it's very helpful for there to be genuine presence of truth in the world, the ambience, the presence of truth. A monkey, throw that monkey wrench in the world, and people say, whoa, this is the kind of a recognition and entitlement that we're looking for, that kind of thing, situation. That helps preclude the climate of megalomania, which is actually one of the dreadful mushrooms that are popping up, funguses that are rising in this world. Mental fungus is we're headed towards, you know, megalomaniacal sort of situations and people in the world, very much so. Where, you know, again, the state exists to worship the leader, so to speak, or the leaderess. And we're going towards that in a strong, strong way. Because we can't help but crave the right kind of recognition for what we truly are. We can't help it. You see, you can't get rid of it. This is the problem, is not knowing what we truly are, trying to deceive ourselves about what we truly are, believing we're these bodies, but we still crave recognition for what we are. And we can never get enough recognition by people. No matter how many bodies recognize this body, it's never enough. It's never good enough. You know, they say, you're the greatest body there's ever been, you know, and ever will be. It's not enough. It's never enough. So what I say is the cure for everybody is to be able to recognize the divinity of everyone else. When you see the divinity of everybody else, then you're cured, actually. Because you are among total divinity. So you must also be entitled to divinity too, right? Because everyone, everything you see, everywhere, it's all divine. It's all divine. And then you're getting the recognition you deserve, because everything is in your presence. I mean, you're in the presence of all this divinity, right? So you must be worthy of it too. That's at least how Jesus explains it, how to get well from our troubles. And this is what I've seen in dreams, and I believe this is true. So we have to start recognizing this, that we're divine, and it's possible to see the divine, and start deferring, and recognizing the entitlement of those who have realized this. They say, "Hey, wait a minute, they've realized what I want to realize. This is important. I want to pay attention and listen to this, and I want that too." So, when there's a lack of that in the world, then the world goes to megalomania, goes in that direction. And you get very foolish people rising to positions of power who have not learned the lessons of history. And different types have not learned the lesson of history. But those who have are not going to claim any sort of great attainment based on their person or their body or any attainment at all in this world. You know, they're going to say, no. The history shows you, you know, what happens, and so many losses and defeats. You know, if you've been through that, and so, you know, as far as leadership in the world goes, you want the people who represent the wisdom of history, and they've been humiliated enough in terms of losses and great battles and struggles, etc. And they realize, hey, you know, I can't really fix the world. It's better just to keep it on a wise stewardship here. What you don't want is those who are all eager and saying, that's my turn now. And I know we can get it done. We just didn't have a chance to get it done, but now we can get it done. And you get this extreme over-optimism. It becomes a very, very dangerous situation. It's like you get the peasants taking over. The wise old-school bureaucrats are actually more helpful, because they say, hey, you know, we understand. Let's not get too ambitious here, okay? Let's keep the balances of power. Let's not try to solve the problems of the world. We realize they can't be solved in the way we're trying to solve them. It's impossible. The only solution is a spiritual solution. which ultimately recognize the sameness, the perfect sameness, which was really, then you realize there isn't any world in the way that we're believing in it at all. That's the only remedy there is. Enlightenment's the only remedy there is. And so these wise, old school diplomats, bureaucrats, who, you know, maybe they've been around for thousands of years in some ways, doing this over and over, and you know, they can keep their heads and say, you know, let's not bite off more than we can chew here. Let's not try to fix the world too much. Let's realize our limitations. They realize their limitations through bitter defeats. They've had so many bitter situations and defeats. And, you know, trying to keep the peace and failing and all this, they realize, wow, well, we need to be pretty humble about our position in the world. Be very humble about it. Instead, we have these eager beavers coming in who think they're vastly smarter than the past. You get this whole generation coming in. Generations that, because of the internet and technology, who feel that they have the tools now which have made them vastly wiser and smarter than anyone in the past. And therefore, they feel for sure they can get the job done. It's just they got to get the old guard out of the way, and then they'll succeed at it. And then you have gender involved in that too, very much so. Feeling that, you know, hey, we haven't had a chance. As soon as we get a chance, we'll be able to fix all the problems. Very dangerous situation. You know, I'll take an old warrior to be king or leader anytime, because for sure they may have had many defeats, many victories, many defeats, bitterness, suffering. They've seen the carnage. They've seen that struggle. And they say, hey, you know what? It's not worth it. It didn't give me what I wanted, and so let's keep a lid on all this youthful ambition. When you have too much youthful ambition that doesn't have the perspective of history, the experience, the bitterness, the ups and the downs, and all that perspective, you know, when you have too much youth pushing the agenda, then you're in severe trouble in this world. And I think half of the world is under the age of 32 or something at this time, and they're definitely pushing to take over the world, lock, stock, and barrel. And that's going to be a disaster here, extreme disaster. In history, you look at it, and conflicts are almost always started by the younger generations who are very ambitious for power, and they think they have the answers. And problems are averted when the younger generation goes to the old tribal elders, you know, and they hold a council, and they say, let's talk this over, let's take a look at this. And when the tribal elders can impress their vision of what's wise upon the eager beaver younger generation, they say, okay, when they defer, then peace is maintained. When they say, now, you know, it's incredible history. It seems like the kings and the queens and the royals, and their children are the ones that actually end up attacking them and killing them. That is true throughout history. There's nobody more dangerous to the rulers than their own children, because their own children are sure that they know how to rule better than these older people. And so again and again and again and again and again, you say assassination of the parents, and they're pushed out of the way, and sometimes the queen, you know, gets their son to get rid of the husband. Often, that happens a lot, actually. And so she can have it all and really be the one pulling the strings, because she has more control over her son than she does over her husband. It is another huge problem throughout history. This is another big, big problem. So you need a council of tribal elders, so to speak, to keep the lid on youthful ambition. Youthful ambition, having, you know, you go through it and you realize, wow, what an idiot I was. You know, what a fool. You know, because I was full of energy and I thought I could just defeat the problems because I was, you know, bulletproof with all this energy and drive, and I can work around the clock and I've got more than the older people. And what's really lacking in this world is just, you know, this stuff, this, you know, I'm really intellectually quick, the quickness, I just need quickness. And they don't have a clue. They don't have a clue of what the problem, the situation in the world really is. So You get too many of those people in too many high places in the world, you're headed for disaster. That's why in history the old sages were so revered. It's so important that people realize, hey, this is the way to keep the peace, is go to these old sages and ask them, what do you think? You know, even the royals would go to these old sages and say, how do we keep the peace? How do we keep our kingdom from fragmenting civil war and all this stuff? And the sages would say, okay, you know, just you know, play it smart. You know, you need to give a little, take a little, you know, balance it out. And you've got to be politically savvy and smart and compromise in various ways to keep the lid on this ambition we have and the desire for entitlement and recognition. The young people feel they don't get enough recognition, so they're going to overthrow the elders and seize power and say, look what I did. Look who am I. Look who I am. You know, but if we have the spiritual goal in this world, Where younger people are brought and realize, hey, I there's this high goal I need to attain, and until I attain this high goal, quote unquote attainment, until I do that, I really haven't done anything of importance. The world is nothing but vanity of vanities. So stop putting that, you know, the idea of seizing recognition and title in this world. Stop believing that's such an important goal. It's not. And if the young people are raised this way, then you have a much better world. Much better world. So humility, modesty, you know, severe modesty, I say, is very important. It's not, hey, look at me, hey, look at me, hey, look at me. Say, hey, don't look at me. It's not worth looking at me, and it's not me, it's not worth looking at you either in those terms. And by doing that, we bring the possibility of seeing everyone as divine much, much closer. Because divinity, of course, has nothing to do with the body. And the body's just a mask, it's a masquerade. And the more we draw attention to the mask, the more we forget who's wearing the mask. What is it that's actually wearing the mask? Stay humble, stay meek, stay very modest, severely modest. And keep asking to see the divine in everyone. How can I see the divine in everyone? And let's get back to our theme here, is the reason why we don't see it, is we don't give it enough attention, is because we don't feel it has any value to us, because we feel we don't recognize the entitlements that it will bring. How can that bring me entitlement, you're thinking? Because nobody can fool you anymore. They can't fool you spiritually. You say, I know who you are. I know who you are. Doesn't matter what you say or how you act or anything. That none of that matters anymore. I know who you are. I know who I am. I know who you are. I know who everyone is. So, you know, you talk about entitlement. Somebody says, "I know who everyone is. I know everyone. They're my closest friends, closest." You know, that's ultimate entitlement, isn't it? Where you realize that everyone's my best friend. And people realize, oh my gosh, this is some kind of uber entitlement here, and then they put down their foolishness. They're willing to at least start abating their foolishness here. Foolishness unabated is a disaster. And we are in that situation in the world right now, is unabated foolishness. It's like nobody's blocking for the quarterback. The defense is just going to absolutely sack and mash the quarterback, right? Everyone stops blocking. It's unabated foolishness. So this is what the great teachers help us with. They're moving us in this right direction. As I've said, Longchenpa, the great Dzogchen Master, Tibetan Master Longchenpa, is working with the situation in the world right now. He's active, very active. Subtly, you know, we say subtly, it's just because our attention doesn't see much value of working that way, but working to recognize divinity in everyone, working to recognize the sameness, the great sameness, for those who are, you know, willing to work on it, he is absolutely working right now on that. The mind stream, the being stream, we would call Longchenpa, absolutely is here. And you might say it's a, you know, the role of what we call the bodhisattva, functioning as a bodhisattva, is one of the Buddhists who put it that way. Absolutely. And, you know, that's a great thing. Jesus is working. That's a great situation. Absolutely, Jesus is working on this. Of Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, these are two proofs that Jesus is absolutely working on this with us. Realizing the dire situation, although of course, don't get into level confusion. There's no situations and no circumstances from the standpoint of reality is true, but from the standpoint of us being deluded about this, the situation can be said to be dire. Or we could say there's a dire situation of unabated foolishness. And it doesn't get better because, again, we have this craving for recognition, for entitlement, because of what we are. That we can't put that away. We can never put it away. So just pretending that you're nobody still doesn't solve the issue. You know, being a homeless person, it's not going to solve the issue. You're still going to crave recognition as a homeless person. You know, you'll say, I didn't get enough recognition. That doesn't work either. That didn't work either, you're going to say. And you know, sometimes I feel like that. Yeah, I said, I need to do that. Maybe that'll get recognition. They say, oh, what a wonderful homeless person they are. How noble they are, you know. But that doesn't get the recognition either. It doesn't. It doesn't. A noble hobo. Yeah. No, it still doesn't. But the ego say, well, why don't you try that? You know, why don't you go ahead and try? I said, no, that's not going to work either. None of that works. Only seeing the divine in everybody actually works. That's it. As I say, I don't have a world problem. I only have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. I don't have any other problems. And only the vision of oneness has value for me. You know, the problems of the world have no value for me whatsoever. Because the problems of the world are these desperate struggle for entitlement recognition. And only the vision of oneness shows me what I need to see. Only the vision of oneness. Let's stop there for a minute. So only the vision of oneness, which is the vision of sameness, which is the vision of divinity, only that has value to me. My throat is starting to only that has value to me. This is true. Only the value, the vision of oneness. Jesus calls it the vision of oneness. Only that has value to me. And keep telling ourselves that. That is true. Which is really means seeing everyone as divine, and I'm putting the Longchenpa's terminology, seeing this vast sameness, the vast sameness of all, this vast sameness. Only that has value to me. Because only then will I feel I'm getting the recognition that I deserve. By being able to give recognition to everybody, you see. Then you realize, wow, I'm able to give this equal recognition of divinity to everyone. And somehow that is the recognition that I deserve too, that I'm able to do this, and that I'm also, everywhere I go, I'm surrounded by this perfect divinity, and that gives us the recognition that we deserve. There's no other way. So Only the vision of oneness has value. The problems of the world have no value to me whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I don't have any world problems. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The world problems have absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. This is our goal. This is our goal. It has to be our goal. So part of the benefit of watching these videos is we are reminded of what our goal truly is, and to value it, and the importance. We have to value it. Only that has value. Nothing else has value for us, actually. Everything else is worthless to us, because it's never enough. And we'll battle on and fight on and with conflict and anger. We'll keep continuing. Even the people at the top, they have the most petty squabbles, you know, because somebody else is claiming more entitlement than them over some little thing. And this is the world. It's an insane asylum, plain and simple. So the idea of these people who think that they're going to fix the problem of the world, problems of the world, they're crazy. Lunatics, demagogues, megalomaniacs, they're dangerous people, actually. Who are in positions, more and more getting the positions of power in the world, where they are overreaching, they're overambitious. They're thinking they have some special ability to do it. And they don't realize the nature of the world, the nature of our situation. It only makes things worse when you do that. The more you keep convincing people that materialism is the answer, the worse the situation gets in this world. Because then everybody's desperately fighting over the resources of the world, trying to get what they want. The idea of this utopian situation, utopia, is only a fool could advance such a notion in this world. A humanist utopia is impossible. It's completely impossible. Because people will always crave greater recognition in whatever various ways. It's never enough. There will always be conflicts. There will always be competition. There will always be one-upsmanship. There will always be, you know, the ego. Always. In this situation. Anything short of the vision of oneness is a dystopia. Okay, it's a dystopian nightmare. And so all these people keep saying they're here to solve all these different problems. You know, they're actually taking you into a dystopian nightmare. Trying to. You don't have to go there. You can go with the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness is right here for us to see, actually. It's just we don't put our attention on it. We can glimpse it and we say, huh, what's that? Kind of like, oh, that's kind of nice. Oh, what is that? What was that? Is it, well, can't be that important. I got to get back to my entitlement chase. You know, I got to keep chasing my tail, chasing the tail of entitlement. Like dogs, they're throwing the ball for the dog. Every time you throw the ball, the dog goes and chases it. Dog's tired. I say, why are you going to chase the ball? You don't have to chase the ball. And the dog says, oh yeah, got to chase the ball. It's my ball. You know, I got to go chase the ball. I say, no, just relax. You don't have to chase the ball. It's kind of trying to get this world to listen to truth. It's kind of like getting a dog, like a shepherd dog, and not chase a ball, you know? That's about how difficult it is. But it's not impossible, right? I mean, you can tell a trained shepherd dog to stay, and you throw the ball, and they won't go get it. But they'll be whining like crazy, you know, which is then full stop in the wow. You got to train them full stop in the wow. Just realize this is actually waking you up from the delusion that you have to chase the ball and that you're a shepherd dog. So we are capable here. We are capable. But the difficulty is like a, you know, Border collie, you know, trying to get a border collie and not chase a ball that you throw. That's their attainment. That's their recognition. They feel like they got to do it. In Silicon Valley, here's just a bunch of border collies here. Really, the people like border collies. They've got to chase that attainment. There's nothing else in their mind. You know, how are we going to, you know, build utopia? This is what the young people believe. They say, we got the tools. You know, you look it up on Wikipedia, how to build a utopia, or YouTube. YouTube got a video tells you how to build a utopia. First, get rid of all the old people. Step number one, right? Get killed all the old people. Step number two, take over all positions. And step number three, tell everybody we're now living in a utopia. Those are the three steps. And of course, everybody will then know that you're so cool that they say, oh, yeah, we must be living in utopia. Look how cool the leaders are. Look how cool our ideas are. We must be. By definition, it must be true. So, yeah, it doesn't, that's a dystopia. What's this fly? There's a fly here. What's that fly doing? It's nighttime. It's dark. It's cold. Where'd that fly come from? Usually, you don't. Where do flies go, by the way, when they're not flying around in the daytime? I've never seen a fly like at night, like sleeping. Where do they hang out? I don't know. Matter of fact, where do all animals hang out in the nighttime? Where wild animals? Where do they go? They just you never see them. I mean, where do squirrels go? Where do birds go? All these birds, we got thousands of birds everywhere, but at nighttime they're all gone. What happened to them? I don't know. When's the last time you saw a sleeping bird at night? Very rarely. I don't know where they go. I know the chickens go to roost, they go into sort of a comatose state. Just do a little smooth out in the wow here. Full stop in the wow. We've been going at a high. We've been going in high speed pursuit. So part of the problem, like for me, is to talk about all this is, you know, lacking a sense of entitlement because it's getting very difficult, because I'm right there, you know, at the you know, seeing this, the recognizing the sameness and the divinity of everyone. It, I see, I can see it's just right there, but I'm not putting my attention, quite putting my attention on it, you know. But so it becomes very difficult to talk about it because I don't, like I said, I don't feel a sense of entitlement to be talking about this stuff at this point. It's almost like you need to be enlightened to talk any further about all this. Maybe what's the, why the camera failed in the videos. So many videos have failed. And my voice is failing. But there are some areas that we can look at, which is what this video is about here, is why do we not see what is actually there to be seen? Because we don't value it at all. We're valuing trying to get recognition for this masquerade, of how clever we are. But recognition of cleverness is not the same as recognizing what we truly are, the sovereignty and the absolute freedom of what we are. It's not the same thing at all. It's like trying to claim an attainment, that the attainment should be able to get more recognition than the one who is imagining and being creative about all this masquerade. And obviously, that doesn't work because we're not feeling the freedom. We're something feels something's wrong. You know, well, where is it? The feeling of freedom that I know I am, and here we are trying to give all the recognition and to attainment. And all the entitlement to attainment, give the entitlement to attainment. It doesn't feel right, it feels all wrong, it feels guilty. So we're not putting our attention on what we could see. Our mind is capable of recognizing this. It's a mental recognition. So we'll get it, and from that standpoint, then it's easier to talk about the sameness and what Longchenpo talks about, what Jesus talks about, what various teachers have talked about. Then it's a lot easier to talk about that because people will actually listen and recognize that you're entitled to talk about it. Where trying to talk about it when people don't recognize you're entitled to talk about it is difficult. Everyone's entitled to talk about it, actually. But we don't see it that way. We're all entitled to our spiritual path. Absolutely. But again, people don't see it that way. And so we kind of reach this point where enlightenment becomes necessary in order to really, say much more of anything. It becomes a necessity, not a luxury. And what is enlightenment again? Just the simple recognition of what's there all along, of the divinity of everybody. And it's not like seeing them, at least from what I sort of gleaned initially, at least I would say, it's not like seeing them as balls of light, but it could be, but it's recognizing this just a fractional amount of divinity within them, recognizing that it's there. Seeing that it's there, recognizing that it's there. That's pretty much what we're talking about, enlightenment. That brings then this true natural entitlement to share it with others, to share this information with others. And you then become aware that you too are divine, and all is divine, and then the vision of oneness dawns, and the sameness, and it, the whole ball of wax is there. And it's only a matter of us paying attention to what we can already see and notice, but we don't give it enough attention at all. And so you can see how if there's a lot of enlightened ones in the world, how helpful that is, because many, many people will start paying attention, more attention to this, to the divinity that is already there. And that would be extremely helpful. And it cuts way down on the megalomania that can arise. And certainly will arise if we don't do this. So we might pray, just ask for the Holy Spirit to help us put our attention on recognizing the divinity. Put our attention there, keep our attention on that. And forget about all the rest of the stuff, because the rest of the stuff will never bring this entitlement that the world needs so desperately. Because you then will only be reacting to other people's desperate attempts to draw attention to their masquerade and gain entitlement through that. And then that creates all the conflict that we're engaged. So to paying attention to what all the accomplishments and goals that people are striving for, that doesn't work. That's not what you should put your attention on at all. It matters not what their station in life is or what their goals are, what they're trying to do, what they're trying to attain. Pay no attention to that at all. Merely see deeper than that. And something about the struggle that they're having, the struggle points to divinity, doesn't it? That, hey, I feel like I'm, recognition deprived. I feel deprived of recognition. The deprivation that people feel here, just recognize that, this sort of deep sense of longing and deprivation, and there's something like that. So we're right on it here. We really are right on it right now. And first day of spring, 2:15, is a great day to be right on it. That's why we'd say in the old days, right on. Hey, right on. That's right on. That was a phrase that we used a lot. Yeah, we'd be talking to, yeah, that's really right on. That's right on it. It means you really have got it. But we're going in the right direction. We're really on track. Right on. So once again, this is so important, it bears repeating over and over and over. What we need to see is actually already there. And our attention can be placed upon it. We've had glimpses of it in the past. Why we don't give it enough attention is because we do not realize that this is actually where we'll find the entitlement that we need. We're so bit desperate, busy seeking for the entitlement that we need to help others, that we don't realize that that doesn't work, and the entitlement will really be gotten by putting our attention on here, of looking at the divinity of everyone. So it's kind of a situation where we're loath to sort of slow down our pursuit of entitlement in other ways. We're feeling like, oh, if I do that, I'll fall behind. I'll be deprived. And so we don't want to give even a second of attention to recognize the divinity of everyone. But if we can tip the scales on this issue, if we can tip the scales and say, hey, it's okay, I don't need to really pay attention to what anyone's trying to attain, because all I need to recognize is that they're already divine, the inherent divinity of all, then you're justified in saying you're enlightened, actually. And the entitlement will come to you automatically from that, actually. Automatically, because people recognize that you know, you're seeing the true value, and you're seeing through the masquerade. So, you know, that deserves being called enlightenment. Absolutely it does. It's super pragmatic. Super pragmatic. Super helpful. It's what the world needs. Absolutely the world needs it. They don't recognize it. They're too much in frantic pursuit of entitlement and recognition, desperately hoping that'll work. They don't know what they need. You know, they're ignorant of it. But when they get it, they'll know. They'll say, oh yeah, this is what I really wanted. It's just you can't get them to tell you what they really want, because they're very confused about it. Look at Ramana Maharshi. Look at Ramana Maharshi. You know, you talk about entitlement. There it is right there. And people just realize, wow. He knows what I am. Really am. He knows what everyone really is. He sees the divine and is not fooled at all by the body and the masquerade, the games we're playing. Not at all in the slightest. And so they said, wow. I'm going to be quiet and get helped by this. We got his due respect and entitlement. People absolutely gave him that. And he didn't hardly say a word. He basically just saying, the game's up. You know, the game is here. The game is totally up. Okay, I'm not fooled at all anymore. And that's it. We need it. The world needs us desperately, because we're going into this terrible time of danger of all the dynamics I've pointed out of this frantic. A drive for unending recognition and entitlement, and feeling that you're entitled to demand entitlement from everyone else. And the world is getting just super close to trouble right now. Russia, China, United States, Middle East, you know, Persian Empire, Iran, India, Pakistan. You just go through the whole thing. And that's just one layer of the whole situation. It goes on and on and on and on and on. You're getting a new type of bureaucrat and leadership everywhere that feel that that's their time to be superstars. And they want to make their mark upon the world. And they want to be, you know, historical. You get these people with these complexes that they feel that they need to be seen as some historical person, historical leader. Very dangerous situation. They want to put their mark on history, as it were, or herstory, as it were. Very dangerous situation. We don't need to put our mark on history. We need to awaken from history or herstory. We need to awaken from that. And say it's all just a masquerade and nothing ever happened. And there actually has never been a world. It's just our conceit that there's a world and that there are people. It's just extreme conceit, extreme arrogance on our part. So, all success to Longchenpa, to Jesus, to Ramana Maharshi, Nanmaya Ma, Buddha, all the great ones from all traditions. All success to them in their efforts to help us. May their efforts bear great fruit at this time. May it bear the fruit that is effective. May it bear effective fruit. And may they throw many monkey wrenches into the situation in the world right now. And may everyone pray for those monkey wrenches to be thrown, for sure. It's a serious situation here. From a pragmatic standpoint. Is it serious? Yes and no. From an abstract, absolute standpoint, nothing. It's no such thing as seriousness. From a pragmatic standpoint, where we have tried to delude ourselves into believing there is, it's quite serious to keep strengthening that delusion. It brings about a great deal of misery and angst and alienation, feelings of, that we don't like at all, actually. And, you know, delay is not something that we really want. So from that standpoint, you would say it is very serious. As again, from the non-dual standpoint, the answer to most questions is really yes and no. Yes and no. Are there any situations? No. But from the standpoint of how we see it, are there situations? Yes. It's both. Yes and no. We get these people who think that all they need to be some great leader is a university education, and you're in big trouble. Really big trouble. I'll take a warrior over those people anytime, because warriors just have experienced wins and losses, so to speak. And they begin to realize that the price, you know, of the conflict, the price of the battle, the price of the struggle and all this kind of stuff. And they're often very pragmatic, and they have to say, they realize, hey, let's be pragmatic here instead of idealistic. You have way too many idealistic people in the world right now. This is the curse of the present times, is universities churn out idealists. The education that people receive in this world is abominable, actually. It's a disgrace. It's a shame. Everyone should be ashamed of it. People should be ashamed of their degrees, not proud. They should be ashamed of their degrees. I was so ashamed of, I said, I'm not going to even play the game anymore of this education. It's a shame how shameful it is. the lack of wisdom, the lack of perspective, is shameful. The hubris, the idealism, all this is shameful. Extreme, you know, lack of spiritual wisdom coming out of universities worldwide. You might even say they're functionally illiterate. That the education that we have is, it turns out, functional illiterates, or even non-functional illiterates. Dysfunctional illiterates, actually, who think that they're very functional. So when you have someone who's very dysfunctional believing they're super functional, you have a problem. Especially when they're telling it, they have the power to tell everyone what to do and what to not do, and what they should value. So we're trying to shed ourselves of this dysfunctional illiteracy that this world actually teaches us and conditions us. I mean, I used to be able to see everything that's going to happen. I used to be able to see easily. It's all there to be seen, actually. And yet I was told that I can't see this. That this is somehow dysfunctional. This is some sign of severe dysfunctionality. And I was supposed to learn their dysfunctionality. And the only way they could prove it was not dysfunctionality is that if I stopped seeing, you know, my functionality, high functionality, because it put them to shame. And so they didn't want to be shamed, which is, you know, very bad, very, very regretful. They should be shamed. Everybody should be ashamed of their degree, ashamed of their ignorance, ashamed of their dysfunctionality. I mean, shame is a powerful tool that people need to feel some shame. You know, feel ashamed that they've wasted, they're, you know, continuing to play the fool. That's shameful. To not know the true dynamics of this world is shameful. Shameful ignorance. I don't think there's a single leader in the world who is anything more than dysfunctional. There may be a few pragmatists around. Who at least might listen a little bit to wisdom as possible. You know, the advertisements now, they have, you know, someone is going to see this Tibetan master on some mountaintop in Tibet, and I finally found you, master. You think, okay, this is how it's going to go. I came to ask you something. And instead, no. They said, what they have now, the commercials, there's some techno commercial saying, how long have you been sitting on this mountaintop? You know, how have you been meditating? He says, wow. Look what I have for you. I have this smartphone for you. You know, all these apps here. Look what you've been missing. You know, and the meditator goes, wow. You know, wow. In other words, all the advertising is designed to misplace our wow. Okay? To misplace our wow. You want a wow? Look at the life of Ananda Mahima, Sri Sri Ananda Mahima. That is a wow if you actually study it. It's difficult now because the books aren't really hardly available anymore. But I used to have every book that was ever written about her, and detailing her life by those who traveled with her, and you talk about a wow. We have no idea. I mean, it was just one wow after the other. they were just continually wowed by what they were seeing and experiencing. That's a wow, for instance, okay? Ramana Maharshi is a wow, for instance. And Jesus Christ is a wow, Buddha's a wow, Longchenpa's a wow, etc., etc. But what we're doing now, these marketers are displacing the wow, where we need the wow to be, onto these, you know, smartphones and apps and all this nonsense. And then using these so-called meditation masters and commercials, some actor playing them or actress, and where they say, "Oh my gosh, what have I been doing all this time? Meditate. I could have been using this technology. I could have been getting a wow out of this technology. What an idiot I am!" You know, this is what they're implying now. These commercials and corporations, their advertising is becoming extraordinarily aggressive in getting us to misplace our wow. Once you misplace your wow, you're effectively a moron. You're a zombie. Plain and simple. So what I did in my life, I've always been placing my wow on the great saints, the great sages, the masters, the gurus. Always reading, always placing my wow on them. As much as possible. So technology didn't entirely, you know, it didn't entirely engulf me. There was some wow factor involved with computers, of course. Yeah, I was like, wow, you know, I can do all these silly graphics and stuff. Wow, I can do Photoshop. Wow, I can do, you know, videos. Wow. But still, the bigger wow is, you know, the enlightened ones, for sure. And that's something that our culture has lost to a large extent. I mean, they still trot Jesus out, and Jesus, you know, walking on the water and feeding the loaves and raising Lazarus, and they try to keep the wow going, you know, by pointing out the miracles that Jesus did. But people have been, you know, getting kind of, you know, that's sort of lost its, some of it, you know, some of its steam that it used to have. And the Catholic Church can't seem to generate any saints anymore. I mean, they're like, who are they going to canonize? Somebody. I just heard it recently. It's ridiculous. I guess it. Oh my gosh, you know. And they're now cutting out the guidelines that they used to use. It. Well, we're going to give them exemption. They don't have to have any miracles, or they don't need to do this, or don't need to do that. And basically saying, hey, if somebody likes this person, let's make them a saint. And maybe, you know, people keep their wow, keep the wow going. So they're trying to keep the wow going. But it doesn't really work when the wow isn't really there, you know. The wow that saints bring is unique to saints, and you cannot manufacture a saint. The church is trying desperately to manufacture saints. Desperately, because the intention is good, okay, because they understand the wow factors, how important it is, and how super, super important this is. Once you lose that wow factor, once that wow factor gets placed on materialism, you're essentially a spiritual zombie, and it's hard to raise a zombie from the dead. You know, it's easier to raise a corpse from the dead than it is a zombie from zombiness. So the church and religions are desperately trying to keep the wow factor where it needs to be, but in doing so, they're having to manufacture, you know, stuff that doesn't have a wow factor to it. You know, Father Junipero Serra, they're going to make canonize him, but there's a bunch of others too. I mean, ex-popes, they might as well, you know, they're going to canonize them, all of them. But there's some others too who basically, you know, I mean, if you're martyred, basically, they say, well, let's make her a saint. You know, the standards have been dropped to like ridiculous levels. Absurd. It's absurd. I'm sorry. And because they don't have any saints. that's the problem, because their teachings have not been sharp enough. Speaking of being sharp enough, it came to my attention yesterday, the Holy Spirit brought to my attention, is in this effort that we're making, which is a great spiritual effort, to put the wow where it needs to be, to recognize, you know, what this entitlement is, necessary entitlement, how to get it, and which is seeing the divinity in all. In other words, be a genuine saint, and being genuine, say it was generates genuine wow factor. That's what helps the world. We need to be very sharp in our clarity, very, very sharp about it, you know. So in our appearance, be sharp looking, and don't be slovenly. Don't be slovenly. Okay. Don't let yourself go like I'm just so laid back and slovenly, my posture's this, and you know, just look like, you know, you're trying to affect, you know, something, like, you know, it's an affectation or something. You know, what we're dealing with here, we're very much on point here. We're very sharp about our focus. We're the opposite of stupid here. And so, you know, I try to keep myself looking, you would say, very severely modest but sharp. Look, okay, modest but sharp, not slovenly. No, not slovenly at all. Because you know, what we're dealing with here is very important here, and so we're taking it very seriously. So I keep my appearance, you know, sharp looking, and at the same time, you know, unassuming and modest. So this is a good standard to hold yourself to. Keep your head up. Keep your posture, your head, the way you look. You know, you're not trendy. You're not trying to impress, but you give the impression of someone who's very intelligent and sharp, and you're not just collapsing into slovenliness. You're not collapsing. You know, you're not collapsing. You can walk with your head. If you walk, I walk. I'm not really looking around. I'm not trying. I just kind of, my head's, eyes are down. You know, that's a modest, very modest way, you know, being. Be very modest, severely modest. But still, keep a sense of dignity about yourself. Keep a sense of sharp dignity about yourself. Absolutely. We're not being defeated. We're not being defeated at all. In fact, we're actually winning. Okay, we're winning. We're not broadcasting it, you know, too severely, but we're winners. Actually, we are the winners here. We're winning big time. We're winning big time. So keep the sense of dignity about that. You know, don't be a slovenly pig. You know, don't let yourself go to seed. You know, don't get inebriated. Don't be goofy. Don't keep dignity about yourself, like saying, "Hey, I'm a big time winner, actually, big time winner," because you are, and you're going to be even a bigger one soon enough. So keep that standard, because to let people know what we're dealing with here is something that you need your full attention. You need to be sharp. You can't be in a slovenly mood here. You're going to miss it. You're going to miss it. Otherwise, people will just, you know, you're gonna steamroll, you know, just steamroll you, and you'll lose your sense of worth. You think, well, I'm worthless here. I mean, nobody cares about what I think about. Well, I sure care, and I'll give you all the great ones that are helping us. They sure care, and ultimately, everybody actually cares. They're just confused about it. But all those who are truly intelligent absolutely care that what you're doing, and that you're working to clarify all this so that you can actually produce a genuine wow factor in the world, genuine entitlement in the world, and, you know, help out the poor Catholic Church, because they can't find anybody right now. give them a hand, you know. They can tell. You can tell. I mean, I monitor the whole thing. I go to Catholic Church and monitoring the whole situation. And you can tell the people there just simply do not have the wow, necessary wow factor. They're not wowed anymore. You know, the bishop comes in and a little buzz, you know, because it's a really great bishop, really wonderful, wonderful person, spiritually, but not a saint. at least not that I can tell. And it does the cardinals, you know, the scandals of rock the church. There's not enough wow factor anymore. And this, of course, the secular materialists have very understood this wow factor, how important it is, and they've certainly sabotaged the church in a lot of ways. The church has also self-sabotaged itself because it's really pretty much a branch of the Roman Empire, actually. It's pretty much just the Roman Empire doing its thing. But also there's a lot of good throughout history from it generating a wow factor. I mean, religion is as good as it generates a genuine wow factor. That's it. Has to have that. Has to have that. Otherwise, you're gonna start putting your wow factor on something else, the bodies and materialism, etc. And you'll start putting them on celebrities. You know, was what you'll do, and divas and celebrities and devos. I don't know if there's a such thing as a devo. I don't think there, but devolutionaries. you'll put your attention there. So religion is as good as the wow factor that it generates. It has to generate that wow factor. And the Catholic Church is no longer generating that wow factor. I mean, the Pope right now, Francis, you know, who loves Pope Francis? The secular materialists love him because they say, wow, this is finally, we got a Pope that lowers the bar, they say this is now the wow factor where it's not at all, and they think that, yeah, this is great. They're saying finally the church is giving up, you know, finally the church is deciding that they don't have any saints, and they're going to now put the wow factor on, you know, all the social programs and social justice and all this kind of stuff, which doesn't generate any wow factor. You know, let's be honest. The church is, whatever influence the church has is because of the saints. Period. The wow factor, the respect, the genuine wow factor of Jesus, the apostles, the saints. That there have been many saints. In all religious traditions, there have been many saints. Actually, call them what you want. That's why the people have genuine respect. It's genuine entitlement there, based on the saints recognizing the divinity of all. Absolutely recognizing the divinity of all. That produces a genuine entitlement, genuine wow factor. And of course, the Roman Empire sort of appropriated that, you might say. Usurped Christianity in a lot of ways for the benefit of the Roman Empire. And then that just continued on. Pontifex Maximus continued on as the Pope, really. And the Vestal Virgins were kind of invested in the Virgin Mary. And, you know, all this stuff sort of got sort of transferred into, you know, the Roman Empire and their religion, which they certainly were obsessed about. They were very, very religious and did so many, many deities and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so they realize, hey, you know, this let's use this religion and sort of mix things together and blend it all together, and that'll really help us you know, keep the wow factor going, because they saw the wow factor in early Christianity. It was genuine, and they said, hey, this can help us a lot, because we're starting to disintegrate, you know, the Persian dynasties, the empire is still at our, you know, at after us, and smallpox is ravaging us, and, you know, a lot of stuff's happening, and so they felt that this could help maintain, you know, and in many ways it did. Even though the Dark Ages came, the Holy Roman Empire kept reasserting itself throughout history, and it did do largely what they wanted it to do. But they appropriated the usurped, in, you might say, I don't know is how you put it, but the wow, genuine wow factor of early Christianity was true. There were all sorts of miracles and healings that took place, which you would expect, and people had genuine deference to it because of the saints. Absolutely. But now it's to a point of farcical, actually. It's farcical. Now they're sainting humanists, basically. I mean, they're going to start sainting humanists, is what they're going to do, which is what the humanists want, which is why they love Pope Francis. They think, hey, maybe this is the Pope is going to start sainting all the humanists. That's, yeah. The humanists already have their saints, like, you know, Mahatma Gandhi and Einstein and Albert Schweitzer. I mean, I don't know. They just have hundreds and hundreds. They have their own pantheon of saints. Absolutely, they do. And so they're eager for the church to start sainting, canonizing humanists, which was what the church is actually doing now. Which removes the genuine wow factor from the church, which then basically causes it to collapse into obedience to the, you know, secular authorities ultimately, because the people won't oppose it at that point. They'll say, yeah. It's then the demagogues arise and the whole world collapses. Actually, civilization collapses when you don't have a religious wow factor, a strong religious wow factor present in the world. The civilization will collapse. It will go into strife, conflict, collapse in a lot of ways. So I have been monitoring the Catholic Church, believe me. For almost, what, how many years now? Almost maybe six, seven years. Very carefully. Because, you know, with 1.2 billion Catholics in the world, it's the most powerful institution, religious institution in the world, actually. So when that collapses, when it loses the genuine wow factor, and then, you know, there's nothing to stop the overall collapse of the world in a lot of ways. Other religions are trying desperately to keep alive their wow factors. It's getting more and more difficult, and they're getting, of course, more and more desperate and angry about it. I think that the Catholic Church has resigned itself, really. Really, our priest is stepping down in a couple months, actually, early retirement. He's sick at heart, spiritually sick at heart, actually. He tried his very best and thought that he was going to really revive the wow factor of the church, and he realizes it failed. And he says his heart's not good, his health is not good or something, but actually it's a spiritual depression he has. He feels defeated, you know, and so he's just going to retreat to some old priest home retreat, and that's it. Give it over to the young frisky priests who are more interested now in, you know, the, you know, humanistic ideals, actually. So you'll see the turnover in the Catholic priests. There's been such a turnover, and they realize the game's up. They do. There's a lot of Catholics that don't like Pope Francis, actually, because they understand what he's about. He wants to keep the institution going, of course, but the wow factor is not there. And he's taking the attention off of that, actually. Of course, if you don't have it, what else are you going to do? You say, well, let's not put our attention there. Let's put it over here. But when you do that, you really no longer have a church. You no longer have a religion, actually. So, yeah, I feel for these priests. Our priest is a super great priest, actually. Very wise. Very smart. And you can, you know, I feel sorry, you can just tell that he's, he has this, you know, what do you call it, inner spiritual crisis, really. I hope someday I can help him. So, yeah, it's too late, you're not going to be able to revive the Catholic Church at this point. You're not going to be able to revive it. It's gone too far. It's no longer generating saints. It's no longer generating saints. It has been going on for a long time. And, you know, of course, with the with the less of wow factor there is, the less saints are generated, because the theology they have is pretty much a mixture of paganism and Christianity. And you can't really get it that way. You have to get it through your own inner drive, you know, to get it. And you have to be impressed by the saints, and you have to be impressed and give deference to them, and realize that they have entitlement, and pay attention to the great saints, and then you can get some help from them. Pray to them for help, and they will help you for sure. It certainly is not the theology of the church that produces saints at all. So when the stops producing the saints, you know, you can't get it through the rituals and the theology and stuff. A lot of that is just Roman Empire religion, and the religion of Rome. A lot of that ritual, a lot of that stuff, is just continuation. Which, and also Rome, of course, was very much part of the Egyptian tradition. Rome had a lot of contact with Egypt for sure, and that got incorporated into their rituals, etc., etc. So you're not going to get it from that. So a lot of Catholics feel like, wow, you know, where do we go for that wow factor, that genuine wow factor? I feel very sorry. I feel very badly for them. It's a tragedy, you know, because they want the wow factor. They want it. It's just not there. It's just not alive. It's not living anymore. They can't generate it. It's not there anymore. You know, and so people say, well, where do we go? You know, where do we go for this wow factor? And of course the priests say, no, only here in the church, that's where you get it. And they're saying, I just gotta wait till I die, and then that's when I get the wow factor. That's what they're, you know, I guess that's what they're resigned to. Well, maybe when I die, I'll get the wow factor. Now, the real wow factor is right here, right now. It's always here, right now. Right here, right now. Recognizing the divinity of all, it's always true right here, right now. Dying is not going to give you that recognition. Because your beliefs are still continue on. Your beliefs are mental. The mind doesn't die. It's just this corpse that finally set it aside. This body corpse, which is, we just finally set it aside. But the mind still has all these beliefs. And so the mind will continue to pursue those beliefs with another corpse, dance with another corpse. Basically, we're just dancing with another corpse, and so we ask another corpse, shall we dance? You know, shall we dance? And then we think the corpse says, sure, but it actually doesn't say anything. We just think that it project on this other corpse, like, oh, this corpse wants to dance with me. Wonderful, I think I'll have a, let's dance. And so you dance another dance. Call it life, but we're just dancing with corpses. This is all we're doing. Body's not even a corpse. It's just nothing. It's just a neutral, made apparent, you know, hologram sort of. Yeah, it's just. But we can say it's a corpse like that because, for the purpose of talking about it. Because the thing is, it's just being nice. I mean, the priests are very nice and very helpful. The good, you know, it's just they're very considerate, compassionate, and helpful, and they dedicate their life. But that is not enough to produce the wow factor. It's not enough to produce what people really need. So they will continue on sinning, what we'll call sinning, you know, desperately struggling for recognition and entitlements, you know, entitlements. The struggle continues, and then they have confession. I confess that I did this and this and this, and that, you know, takes the pressure off of them psychologically for a while. But it doesn't solve the problem at all. It doesn't solve it. But the idea of taking the pressure off, they feel at least it prevents things from getting worse, you know. And so there's something to that. But the wow factor still has to be there. And just good works do not produce the wow factor. They do not. They do not. That's why this Pope is mistaken. He's overemphasizing works by a long shot. wrong emphasis. He's just trying to keep the money coming in, basically. Trying to attract young people. I mean, he's afraid, you know, afraid they need, if you know, they stop attracting young people, and then they're going to have a problem. So they're basically trying to turn the church in a way which, you know, seems to be championing the values of the younger generation. Half the world's under 32. So that they're marketing. They're what they're doing. They're marketing. And most young people don't really believe in saints, actually. Their wow factor is technology. Facebook, basically. You know, wow, I'm on Facebook. Wow, I just got a like on Facebook. Wow. This is their wow factor. Holy cow. I just sent a picture to somebody. I just tagged a picture. And I just, you know, this is all like, wow, I'm so, this is so incredible. This is so amazing, you know. Meanwhile, Jesus is raising someone from the dead, and then they shrug it off and like, eh, this, what's that? I just got another like on Facebook. What are you talking? Oh, Jesus raised someone from the dead. Oh, ding, what's that? Oh, my phone, another like on Facebook. Oh, my God. Or my story's got a, people, someone read my story. I've gotten some views. Oh, my gosh. This smartphone's incredible. It just keeps telling me how awesome I am, how much recognition I'm getting, how much entitlement I have. Wow, this is amazing. So all these gadgets are designed to give us this false idea of like how important we are, how much entitlement we have. Look how many friends I have on Facebook. You know, wow, I've got thousands of friends. I'm super important. I'm super entitled. This is what this technology is all about. Actually, it's a new religion. It is a new religion, but it's based on this fake wow, this ridiculous fake wow. You know, look how many friends I have. Look how many corpses. Like my corpse, you know, how many corpses are acknowledging this corpse here, these corpses are acknowledging this corpse here, and this corpse is acknowledging those corpses over there, and wow, we got a tally going. Wow, it's you know, totally superficial this whole technology thing, social media, totally superficial, and yet this is where the wow factor is being displaced to, you know. But I'm not deceived. Be not deceived by that, but of course if you don't have genuine wow factor going for you, you're going to be deceived. This is the trouble. So for me, the lives of the saints were always super important. I always was just studying and reading about the lives of the saints. Wherever I went, I'd have a book, I'd find a book. I was always searching out books that talked about the lives of the saints. For instance, Autobiography of a Yogi by Paramahansa Yogananda. He talks about all these saints, you know, in India. And you know, I was just like, I said, that's just fabulous. That's just great. Put your attention on this. And so always seeking out books and writings, teachings, videos, whatever, about the saints, the gurus, the masters, the sages. And is this frozen up? Yeah, 227. Has this frozen up? No, it's still going. It's trying to freeze up on me here. It's still going. Only two hours and 27 minutes. Is that it? It seems like I've been talking longer than that. What time did I start? I don't know. Okay, whatever. Gosh. But it's good stuff. It's still good stuff here. Very good stuff. So we've outed technology for what it actually is here in this video, haven't we? Wow. Displacing the wow. It's an intentional displacement of the wow. It's a fake religion. It's a fake religion. It is a fake religion. Technology is a fake religion. Okay, hear that? Very good. It is a fake religion. Okay. True religion is only as good as the genuine wow, which is a response to enlightened being saints who what is that? Seeing those who see the divinity in all, actually see it, factually recognize and see it. And that produces this wow feeling of genuine entitlement and deference in us. We say, wow, this is really in true entitlement. Wow, I'm going to pay attention to this. This is what religion is made of. And so this displacing this wow onto gadgets, like, wow, someone just sent me a friend request. Wow, I must be really important. My physical being person here must be important. You know, I'm trying to build up a fake entitlement complex based on form, time, space, process, and form. That is a false religion. That is a false religion. So we have most certainly identified the false religion of the world. And you can call it Antichrist if you want to. Christ should refer to a genuine religion, genuine wow, genuine, the genuine road to enlightenment. And false religion is takes you away from that. And that you call that the anti, you could call it Antichrist. Absolutely you could. But I just call it, you know, false religion. It is absolutely a false religion. Which is why I don't have a smartphone. That's the Eucharist of the false religion, so to speak, that keeps you constantly informed of, you know, how likable am I? How sociable am I? How you know, this is constant feedback about, you know, what are my entitlements? What is my recognition? I need my recognition updated. Now, and I realize how addictive that is because, of course, even on YouTube, I look at, you know, how many viewers do I have, you know, that kind of thing. And so it can become extraordinarily addictive and it becomes a religion. It becomes a religion. And the young people of this world have been indoctrinated into this false religion already. And speaking of that, they're now pressing these big tech companies. Are pressing, marketing and pressing parents, etc., for these gadgets.